The 40 Rules of Love. Part 1. Earth. The things that are solid absorb and still. Shams. Beeswax candle flickered in front of my eyes above the cracked wooden table. The vision that took hold of me this evening was a most lucid one. There was a big house with a courtyard full of yellow roses in a bloom, and in the middle of the courtyard a well with the coolest water in the world. It was a serene, late autumn night with a full moon in the sky. A few nocturnal animals hooted and hawed in the background. In a little while, a middle-aged man with a kind face, broad shoulders and deep-set hazel eyes walked out of the house looking for me. His expression was vexed and his eyes were immensely sad. "Shams, Shams, where are you?" he shouted left and right. The wind blew hard and the moon hid behind the cloud, as if I did not want to witness what was about to happen. The owls stopped hooting, the bats stopped flapping their wings, and even the fire in the hearth inside the house did not crackle. An absolute stillness descended upon the world. The man slowly approached the well, bent over, and looked down below. "Shams, dearest," he whispered. "Are you there?" I opened my mouth to answer, but no sound came out of my lips. The man leaned closer and looked down into the well again. At first he could not see anything other than the darkness of the water. But then, deep down at the bottom of a well, he caught sight of my hand floating aimlessly on the rippling water like a drifting craft after a heavy storm. Next he recognized a pair of eyes, two shiny black stones, staring up at the full moon now coming out from behind thick dark clouds. My eyes were fixed on the moon, as if waiting for an explanation from the skies for my murder. The man fell on his knees, crying and pounding his chest. "They killed him. They killed my Shams," he said. Just then a shadow scurred out from behind a bush and with fast furtive moves it hopped over the garden wall like a wild cat. But the man did not notice the killer. Seized by a crushing pain, he screamed and screamed until his voice shattered like glass and flew all over into the night in tiny prickly shirts. "Hey you, stop screaming like a maniac. Get that awful noise and I am going to kick you out," I said. "Shut up. Do you hear me? Shut up." It was a male voice that shouted these words, booming menacingly close. I pretended not to hear him, preferring to stay inside my vision. I wanted to learn more about my death. I also wanted to see the man with the saddest eyes. Who was he? Who was he related to me, and why was he so desperately looking for me on an autumn night? But before I could sneak another look at my vision, someone from the other dimension grabbed me by the arm and shook me so hard I felt my teeth rattle in my mouth. It yanked me back into this world. Slowly, reluctantly, I opened my eyes and saw the person standing beside me. He was a tall, corpulent man with a hoary beard and thick mustache, curved and pointy at the tips. I recognized him as the innkeeper. Almost instantly, I noticed two things about him: that he was a man used to intimidating people with a tough talk and sheer violence, and that right now he was furious. "What do you want?" I asked. "Why are you pulling my arm?" "What do I want?" The innkeeper roared with a scowl. "I want you to stop screaming for starters. That's what I want. You are scaring away my customers." "Really? Have I been screaming?" I muttered as I managed to pull myself from. You were screaming like a bear with a thorn stuck in its paw. "What happened to you? Did you doze off during dinner? You must have had a nightmare or something." I knew that this was the only plausible explanation, and if I went along with it, the innkeeper would be satisfied and leave me in peace. Still, I did not want to lie. "No, brother, I have never felt asleep nor had a bad dream. I said, actually, I never have dreams. How do you explain all that screaming then? The innkeeper wanted to know. I had a vision. That's different. He gave me a bewildered look and sucked on the ends of his mustache for a while. Finally, he said, you dervishes are as crazy as rats in the pantry, especially you wandering types. All day long, you fast and pray and walk under the scorching sun. No wonder you start hallucinating. Your brain is fried. I smiled. He could be right. They say there is a thin line between losing yourself in God and losing your mind. Two serving boys appeared just then, carrying between them a huge tray stacked with plates, freshly grilled goat, dried salted fish, spiced mutton, wheat cakes, chicken and with meatballs. They met around the hall distributing them, filling the air with the scent of onion, garlic and spices. When they stopped by my end of the table, I got myself a bowl of steaming soup and some dark bread. Do you have money to pay for those? The innkeeper asked with a flicker of condescension. No, I don't, I said, but allow me to offer an exchange. In return for the food and the room, I could interpret your dreams. To this, he responded with a sneer, his arms akimbo. That's right. I am a dream interpreter. You does not have dreams of his own. I should toss you out of here. Like I said, you dervishes are nuts, the innkeeper said, spitting out all the words. Here is some advice for you. I don't know how old you are, but I'm sure you have prayed enough for both worlds. Find a nice woman and settle down. Have children that will help to keep your feet on the ground. What is the point of roaming the world when it's the same misery everywhere? Trust me, there is nothing new out there. I have customers from the farthest corners of the world. After a few drinks, I hear the same stories from them. Men are the same everywhere. Same food, same water, same old crap. I am not looking for something different. I am looking for God, I said. My quest is a quest for God. Then you are looking for him in the wrong place, he retorted, his voice suddenly thickened. God has left this place. We don't know when he will be back. My heart flailed away at my chest wall upon hearing this. When one speaks ill of God, he speaks ill of himself, I said, an odd slanted smile etched along the innkeeper's mouth. In his face, I saw bitterness and indignation and something else that resembled childish hurt. Doesn't God say I'm closer to you than your jugular vein? I asked, God is not someplace far up in the sky. He is inside each and every one of us. That is why he never abandons us. How can he abandon himself? But he does abandon, the innkeeper remarked, his eyes cold and deficient. If God is here but does not move a finger when we suffer the worst end, what does that tell us about him? It is the first rule, brother, I said. How we see God is a direct reflection of how we see ourselves. If God brings to mind mostly fear and blame, it means there is too much fear and blame welled inside us. If we see God as full of love and compassion, so are we, the innkeeper immediately objected. But I could see that my words had surprised him. How is that any different than saying God is a product of our imagination? I don't get it. But my answer was interrupted by a ruckus that broke out at the back of the dining hall. When we turned in that direction, we saw two rough-looking men yelling drunken gibberish. With unbridled insolence, they were bullying the other customers, snatching food off their bowls, drinking from their cups, and should anyone protest, mocking them like two naughty MacTab boys. Somebody should take care of these troublemakers, don't you think? Hissed the innkeeper between clenched teeth. Now watch me. In a flash, he reached the end of a hall, yanked on one of the drunken customers from his seat, and punched him in the face. The man must not have been expecting this at all, for he collapsed on the floor like an empty sack. A barely audible sigh came out of his lip, but other than that, he made no noise. The other man proved stronger, and he fearlessly fought back, but it did not take the innkeeper long to knock him down too. He kicked his unruly customer in the ribs and then stomped on his hand, grinding it under his heavy boots. We heard the crack of a finger breaking, or maybe more. "Stop it," I exclaimed. "You are going to kill him. Is that what you want?" As a Sufi, I had sworn to protect life and do no harm. In this world of illusions, so many people were ready to fight without any reason, and so many others fought for a reason. But the Sufi was the one who would not fight even if he had a reason. There was no way I could resort to violence. But I could thrust myself like a soft blanket between the innkeeper and the customer to keep them apart. "You stay out of this, Darvish, or I will beat the hell out of you too," the innkeeper shouted. But we both knew he was not going to do that. A minute later, when the serving boys lifted up the two customers, one of them had a broken finger and the other a broken nose, and there was blood all over. A fearful silence descended on the dining hall. Proud with the awe he would inspire, the innkeeper gave me a sidelong look. When he spoke again, it sounded as if he were addressing everyone around, his voice soaring high and wide, like a murderer bird boasting in the open sky. "You see, Darvish, it was not always like this. Violence wasn't my element, but it is now. When God forget about us down here, it fall upon us common people to turn up and restore justice. So next time you talk to him, you tell him that. Let him know that when he abandon his lambs, they won't meekly wait to be slaughtered. They will turn into wolves." I shuddered as I motioned towards the door. "You are mistaken. Am I wrong in saying I was a lamb once and have turned into a wolf?" "No, you got that right. I can see that you have become a wolf indeed. But you are wrong in calling what you are doing justice." "Wait, I haven't finished with you," the innkeeper shouted behind my back. "You owe me. I return for food and bed. You were going to interrupt my dreams. I will do something better," I suggested. "I will read your palm." I turned back and walked toward him, looking hard into his burning eyes. Intestinatively, distrustfully, he flinched. Still, when I grabbed his right hand and turned his palm up, he did not push me. I inspected the lines and found them deep, crack marking uneven paths. Bit by bit, the colors in his aura appeared to me, a rusty brown and a blue so pale as to be almost gray. His spiritual energy was hollowed out and thinned around the edges, as if it had no more strength to defend itself against the outside world. Deep inside, the man was no more alive than a wilting plant. To make up for the loss of his spiritual energy, we had doubled up his physical energy, which he used in excess. My heart beat faster, for I had started seeing something, at first dimly, as if behind a veil. Then, with increasing clarity, a scene appeared in front of my eyes. A young woman with a chestnut hair, bare feet with black tattoos, and an embroidered red shawl draped over her shoulders. You have lost a loved one, I said, and took his left palm in my hand. Her breast swells with milk, and her belly so huge, it looked as if it could rip apart. She is stuck in a hut of fire. There are warriors around the house, riding horses with silver gilded saddles. The thick smell of burning hay and human flesh. Mongol riders, their noses flat and wide, necks thick and short, and hard as rock. The mighty army of Genghis Khan. You have lost your two loved ones. I corrected myself. Your wife was pregnant with your first child. His eyebrows clamped down, his eyes fixed on his leather boots. And his lips tightly pursed, the innkeeper's face creased into an unreadable map. Suddenly he looked old beyond his years. I realized that it's no consolation to you, but I think there is something you should know, I said. It wasn't the fire or the smoke that killed her. It was a wooden plank in the ceiling that collapsed on her head. She died instantly, without any pain. You always assumed she had suffered terribly, but in reality, she did not suffer at all. The innkeeper furrowed his brow, bowed under a pressure only he could understand. His voice turned raspy as he asked, "How do you know all that?" I ignored the question. You have been blaming yourself for not giving her a proper funeral. You still see her in your dreams, crawling out of the pit she was buried in. But your mind is playing games with you. In truth, your wife and son are both fine, traveling in infinity, as free as a speck of light. I then added, measuring each word, you can become a lamb again because you still have it in you. Upon hearing this, the innkeeper pulled his hand away as if he had just touched a sizzling pan. I don't like you, Darwish, he said. I will let you stay here tonight. But make sure you are gone early in the morning. I don't want to see your face around here again. It was always like this. When you spoke the truth, they hated you. The more you talked about love, the more they hated you. Ila. Bested by the tension that followed the argument with David and Janet, Ila was so drained she had to stop reading Sweet Blasphemy for a while. She felt as though the lid of a boiling cauldron had suddenly been lifted, emitting old conflict and new resentment in the rising steam. Unfortunately, it was no one other than she who had lifted that lid, and she had done it by dialing Scott numbers and asking him not to marry her daughter. Later in her life, she would deeply regret everything she had uttered during this phone conversation. But on this day in May, she was so sure of herself and the ground beneath her feet that she could not for the life of her fathom any dire consequence for her insurance. Hi Scott, this is Janet's mom, Ella, she said, trying to sound jovial, as if calling her daughter's boyfriend was something she did all the time. Do you have a minute to talk? Mrs. Robinson, how may I help you? Scott stammered, surprised but ever so civilized, and in no less civilized tone. Ella told him that although she had nothing against him personally, he was too young and inexperienced to marry her daughter. Upset as he might be to receive this call now, she added, someday in the not so distant future he would understand and even thank her for warning him in time. Until then, she asked him to kindly drop the subject of marriage and to keep this phone conversation between the two of them. There was a thick, dense silence. Mrs. Rubinstein, I don't think you understand, Scott said. When he finally found his wife, Janet and I love each other. There it was again. How could people be naive enough to expect love to open door for them? They look at love as if it were a magic wand that could fix everything with one miraculous touch. But Ella did not say any of this. Instead, she said, "I understand how you feel. Believe me, I do. But you are too young and life is long. Who knows? Tomorrow you might fall in love with someone else. Mrs. Rubinstein, I don't want to be rude, but don't you think the same rule applies to everyone, including yourself? Who knows? Tomorrow you might fall in love with someone else." Ella chuckled louder and longer than she intended. "I am a married woman. I have made a choice for a lifetime. So did my husband, and that's actually my point. Marriage is a serious decision which needs to be considered very carefully. Are you telling me not to marry your daughter, who I love, because I might love an unidentified other in an indefinite future?" Scott demanded. The conversation went downhill from there, filled with distress and disappointment. When they finally hung up, Ella headed to the kitchen and did what she always did at times of emotional unrest. She cooked. Half an hour later, she received a call from her husband. "I can't believe you called Scott and to ask him not to marry our daughter. Tell me you didn't do this," Ella gasped. "Wow, words get out fast. Honey, let me explain." But David interjected tensely. "There is nothing to explain. What you did was wrong," Scott told Janet, "and now she's extremely upset. She will be staying with her friend for a few days. She doesn't want to see you right now." He paused briefly. "And I don't blame her." That evening, Janet was not the only one who did not come home. David sent Ella a text message informing her of a sudden emergency that had arisen. There was no explanation as to the nature of emergency. It was so unlike him and against the spirit of their marriage. He might flirt with woman after woman, could even sleep with them and spend his money on them for all she knew. But he had always come home and taken his place at the table in the evenings. No matter how deep the rift between them, she always cooked and he always ate. Gladly and gratefully, whatever she put on his plate. At the end of each dinner, David never failed to thank her. A heartfelt thank you that she always took to be a quoted apology for his infidelities. She forgave him. She always did. This was the first time her husband had acted this brave, and Ella blamed herself for the change. But then again, guilt? Was Ella Rubinstein's middle name? When she sat on the at the table with her twins, Ella's guilt gave away too malignantly. She resisted Abby's plea to order pizza and Orly's attempt not to eat anything, forcing them to munch on wild rice with green peas and roast beef with mustard glaze. And although on the surface she was the same hand, unconcerned mother, she felt a surge of despair rise in her, a sharp taste in her mouth, so like bile. When dinner was over, Ella sat at the kitchen table on her own, finding the stillness around her heavy unsettled. Suddenly, the food she had cooked, the outcome of hours of hard work, seemed not only dull and boring, but easily replaceable. She felt sorry for herself. It was a pity that, at almost 40, she had not been able to make more of her life. She had so much love to give and yet no one demanding it. Her thoughts turned to sweet blasphemy. She was intrigued by the character of Shams of Debrez. It would be nice to have someone like him around. She joked to herself, never a dull day with a guy like him. And somehow, the image that popped up in her mind was of a tall, dark-looking, mysterious man with leather pants, a motorcycle jacket and black hair that fell to his shoulder, riding a shiny red Harley Davidson with multicolored tassels hanging from the handlebar. She smiled at the image. A handsome, sexy, Sufi motorcyclist riding fast on an empty highway. Wouldn't it be nice to get picked up while hitching by a guy like that? Ella then wondered what she Ames would see if he read her palm. Would he explain to her why her mind turned from time to time into a coven of dark thoughts? Or how come she felt so lonely even though she had a large loving family? What about the colors in her aura? Were they bright or bold? Had anything in her life been bright and bold lately or ever? It was then, there, while sitting alone at the kitchen table with only a faint glimmer of light from the oven, that Ella realized that despite her high-flying words denying it, and despite her ability to keep a stiff upper lip, deep inside she longed for love. Shams, burdened with loneliness, all fast asleep in separate rooms, were more than a dozen weary travelers upstairs at the inn. I stepped over bare feet and hands to reach my empty bedroll that reeked of sweat and mold. I lay there in the dark, mulling over the day's event and reflecting on any divine signs I might have witnessed, but in my haste or ignorance, failed to appreciate. Since I was a boy, I had received visions and heard voices. I always talked to God, and He always responded. Some days, I ascended all the way up to the seventh sky as light as I whisper. Then I descended into the deepest pit of the earth, surfaced with smells of soil, hidden away like a rock buried under mighty oaks and sweet chestnuts. Every so often, I lost my appetite for food and went without eating for days on end. None of these things scared me, though in time I had learned not to mention them to others. Human beings tended to disparage what they could not comprehend. I had learned that firsthand. The first person to misjudge my vision was my father. I must have been 10 years old when I started seeing my guardian angel on a daily basis and was naive enough to think that everyone else did as well. One day, while my father was teaching me how to build a carriage chest so that I could become a carpenter like him, I told him about my guardian angel. "You have a wild imagination, son," my father said dryly, "and you better keep it to yourself. We don't want to upset the villagers again." A few days before, the neighbors had complained about me to my parents, accusing me of acting strange and scaring their kids. "I don't understand your ways, my son. Why can't you accept that you are no more remarkable than your parents?" my father asked. "Every child takes after his father and mother. So have you." That was when I realized that although I love my parents and crave their love, they were strangers to me. "Father, I'm from a different egg than your other child. Think of me as a duckling raised by hens. I'm not a domestic bird destined to spend his life in a chicken coop. The water that scales you rejuvenates me, for unlike you, I can swim. And swim I shall. The ocean is my home. If you are with me, come to the ocean. If not, stop interfering with me and go back to the chicken coop." My father's eyes grew large, then small and distant. "If this is the way you talk to your father now," he said gravely, "I wonder how you will address your enemies when you grow up." Much to the chagrin of my parents, the vision did not disappear as I got older. If anything, they became more intense and gripping. I knew I made my parents nervous, and I felt guilty for upsetting them so. But the truth is, I did not know how to end the vision. And even if I had, I don't think I would have. Before long, I left my house for good. Since then, the breeze has become a smooth, sweet word, so fine and light that it melts on my tongue. Three scents accompany my memories of this place: cutwood, poppy seed bread, and the soft, crisp smell of snow. I have been a wandering dervish ever since, not sleeping in the same place more than once, not eating out of the same bowl twice in a row, every day seeing different faces around me. When hungry, I earn a few coins by interrupting dreams. In this state, I roam east and west, searching for God high and low. I hunt everywhere for a life worth living and a knowledge worth knowing. Having roots nowhere, I have everywhere to go. During my travels, I have taken all sorts of roads,
From popular trade routes to forgetting crags where you would not run into Seoul for days on end. From the coast of the Black Sea to the cities of Persia. From the vast deeps of Central Asia to the sand dunes of Arabia. I have passed through thick forests, flat grasslands and deserts. Sojourned at caravanseries and hostels. Consulted with the learned man in age-old libraries. Listen to tutors teaching little children with math tabs, discussed tafsir and logic with students in madrasa. Visited temples, monasteries and shrines, mediated with hermits in their caves. Performed zikr with dervishes, fasted with sages and dined with heretics. Danced with shams under the full moon.
Come to know people of all faith, ages and professions and witnessed misfortunes and miracles alike. I have seen poverty-stricken villages, fields blackened by fire and plundered towns where the rivers ran red and there were no men left alive above the age of 10. I have seen the worst and the best in humanity. Nothing surprises me anymore. As I went through all these experiences, I began to compile a list that was not written down in any book, only inscribed in my soul. This personal list I call the basic principle of the itinerant mystics of Islam. To me, these were as universal, dependable and invariable as the laws of nature. Together, they constituted the 40 rules of the religion of love, which could be attained through love and love only. And one of those rules said, the path to the truth is a labor of the heart, not of the head. Make your heart your primary guide, not your mind. Meet, challenge, and ultimately prevail over your nafs with your heart. Knowing your ego will lead you to the knowledge of God. It had taken me years to finish working on these rules. All 40 of them, and now that I was done, and now that I was done, and now that I was done. Lately, I had been having many visions in this direction. It wasn't depth that worried, with a light so bright that the faces of the travelers in their beds turned lurid blue. The air inside smelled fresh and alive, as if all the windows had been pushed open, and a gusty window brought in the scent of lilies and jasmine from faraway gardens. Go to Baghdad, fluted my guardian angel in a sing-song voice. What is awaiting me in Baghdad? I ask. You pray for a companion, and a companion you will be given. In Baghdad, you will find the master who will point you in the right direction. Tears of gratitude welled up in my eyes. Now I knew that the man in my vision was no other than my spiritual companion. Sooner or later, we were destined to meet. And when we did, I will learn why his kind hazel eyes were eternally sad and how I came to be murdered on an early spring. Ila. Before the sun had set and the children had came back home, Ila placed a bookmark in the manuscript and put sweet blasphemy aside. Curious about the man who had written the novel, she went online and googled A.Z. Zahra. Wondering, words would pop up, but not expecting much. To her surprise, a personal blog appeared. The colors on the page were predominantly amethyst and turquoise. And on top of the page, a male figure with a long white skirt reeled slowly. Having never seen a reeling dervish before, Ila took a careful look at the picture. The blog was titled An Eggshell Named Life, and beneath it, there was a poem with the same title. Let us choose one another as companions. Let us sit at each other's feet. Inwardly, we have many harmonies. Think not that we are only what we see. The page was full of postcards from cities and sites all around the world. Underneath each postcard, there were comments about the particular place. It was while reading these that Ila came across three pieces of information that immediately drew her attention. First, that the A in A.Z. Zahra stood for Aziz. Second, that Aziz regarded himself as a Sufi. Third, that at the moment he was traveling somewhere is Guatemala. In another section, there were samples of the photos he had taken. Most were
portraits of people of all colors and stripes, despite their stark differences. They resemble one another in one curious respect. All the people in all the portraits had something visibly missing. For some, the missing element was a simple thing, like an earring, a shoe, or a button, while for others, it was much more substantial, like a tooth, a finger, or sometimes a leg. Underneath the photo, it read, "No matter who we are or where we live, deep inside, we all feel incomplete. It's like we have lost something and we need to get it back. Just what that something is, most of us never find out, and of those who do, even fewer manage to go out and look for it." Ila scrolled up and down the webpage. Click on every postcard to enlarge it and read every comment Aziz had made. At the bottom of the page, there was an email address, azizzahra@gmail.com, which she wrote down on a piece of paper. Next to that, she found a poem by Rumi. "Choose love, love, without the sweet life of love. Living is a burden, as you have seen." It was while reading this poem that a more specular thought flashed across her mind. For a fleeting moment, it felt as if everything Aziz said Zahra included in his personal blog, the pictures, the comments, the quotations, and the poems were written for her eyes only. It was a strange and slightly superstitious thought, but one that made perfect sense for her. Later in the afternoon, Ila sat by the window, feeling tired and slightly down, the sun heavy on her back and the air in the kitchen filled with the smells of the brownies she was baking. She had sweet blasphemy open in front of her, but her mind was so preoccupied, she could not concentrate on the manuscript. It occurred to her that perhaps she too should write her own set of ground rules. She could name it the 40 Rules of Deeply Settled Earthy Housewife. Rule number 1, she murdered. Stop looking for love. Stop running after impossible dreams. There are surely more important things in life for a married woman about to be 40. But her own joke produced an obscure discomfort in Ila, reminding her of bigger worries. Unable to hold herself back anymore, she gave her elder daughter a call. She got her answering machine. "Janet, dear, I know it was wrong of me to call Scott, but my intentions were not bad. I just wanted to make sure." She paused, deeply regretting not planning this message in advance. She could hear the soft rustle of the answering machine recording in the background. It made her nervous to think that the tape was rolling and the time was running short. "Janet, I'm sorry for the things that I do. I know I should not complain when I'm so blessed, but it's just that I'm so unhappy." Click. The answering machine came to a stop. Ila's heart constricted with the shock of what she had just said. What had come over her? She had not known she was unhappy. Was it possible to be depressed and not known it? Oddly enough, she did not feel unhappy about confessing her unhappiness. She had not been feeling much of anything lately. Her gaze slid to the piece of paper on which she had written Aziz Zahra's email address. The address looked simple, unpretentious, and somehow inviting. Without giving it much thought, she went to her computer and started composing an email. "Dear Aziz Zahra, my name is Ila. I am reading your novel, Sweet Blasphemy, in my capacity as a reader for the literary agency. I have only just begun and I am enjoying it immensely. This, however, is my personal opinion and is not reflective of the views of my boss. Whether I like your novel or not, I have barely any influence on the final decision as to whether we will take you as a client. It seemed like you believe that love is the essence of life and that nothing else matters.
It's not my intention to get into fruitless debate with you on this matter. Suffice it to say that I do not completely agree, but this is not why I am writing to you. I am writing because the timing of my reading Sweet Blessedly could not have been more better. Currently, I am trying to persuade my elder daughter not to marry so young, the day before I ask her boyfriend to call off their marriage plans. Now, my daughter hates me and refuses to talk to me. I have a feeling you two would get along well, as you seem to have every similar views on love. I'm sorry to pour my personal problem out to you. That was not my intention. Your personal blog, that is where I found your email address, says you are in Guatemala, traveling around the world. Must be quite a thrill. If you happen to came to Boston, perhaps we could meet in person and talk over a cup of coffee. Best wishes, Ella. Her first email to Aziz was not a letter so much as an invitation, a cry for help, but Ella had no way of knowing this as she sat in the silence of her kitchen and composed a note to an unknown writer. She did not expect to meet now or at any time in the future. The Master. Baghdad took no more note on the arrival of Champs of the Race, but I will never forget the day he came to our modest Darwish Lodge. We had important guests that afternoon. The High Judge had dropped by with the group of his men, and I suspected there was more than cordiality behind his visit. Renowned for his dislike of Sufism, the judge wanted to remind me that he kept an eye on us, just as he kept an eye on all the Sufis in the area. The judge was an ambitious man. He had a broad face, a sagging belly, and short, stubby fingers, each with a precious ring. He had to stop eating so much, but I suspected that nobody had the courage to tell him, not even his doctor. Coming from a long line of religious scholars, he was one of the most influential men in the area. With one ruling, he could send a man to the gallows, or he could just as easily pardon a convict's crime. Lifting him up from the darkest dungeon, always dressed in fur coat and expensive garments, he carried himself with the grandeur of someone who was sure of his authority. I did not approve of his big ego, but for the well-being of our Lord, I did my best to remain on good terms with this man of influence. We live in the most magnificent city in the world, the judge pronounced as he popped a fig into his mouth. Today, Baghdad overflows with refugees running away from the Mongol army. We provide them safe haven. This is the center of the world, don't you think, Baba Zaman? This city is a gem, no doubt, I said carefully. But let us not forget that cities are like human beings. They are born, they go through childhood and adolescence, they grow old and eventually they die. At this moment in time, Baghdad is in its late youth. We are not as wealthy as we used to be at the time of Caliph Harun al-Rashid. Though we can still take a measure of pride in being a center of trade, craft and poetry. But who knows what the city will look like 1,000 years from now. Everything might be different. Such pessimism. The judge shook his head as he reached out another bowl and picked a date. The Abbasid rule will prevail and we will prosper. That is, of course, if the status queue is not disrupted by the great traitors among us. The Abbasid rule will prevail and we will prosper. That is, of course, if the status queue is not disrupted by the traitors among us. There are those who call themselves Muslim, but their interpretation of Islam is far more dangerous than threats from infidels. I chose to remain silent. It was no secret that the judge, with the individualistic and esoteric interpretation of Islam, were troublemaker. He accused us of paying no heed to the Sharia and thus disrespecting the man of authority, men like him. Sometimes I had the feeling he would rather have all Sufis kicked out of Baghdad. Your brotherhood is harmless, but don't you think some Sufis are beyond the pale? The judge asked, stroking his beard. I did not know how to respond to that. Thank God, just then we heard a knock on the door. It was the ginger-haired noise. He made a beeline toward me and whispered in my ear that we had a visitor, a wandering dervish who insisted upon seeing me and refused to talk to anyone else. Normally, I would have asked the noise to take a newcomer to a great welcoming room, give him warm food and make him wait until the guest had left. But as the judge was giving me a hard time, it occurred to me that a wandering dervish could dispel the tension in the room by telling us colorful stories from faraway lands. So I asked the noise to bring the man in. A few minutes later, the door opened and in walked a man dressed head to toe in black, lank, gaunt, and of indeterminate age. He made a sharp move, deeply set pitch black eyes, and dark hair that fell over his eyes in thick curls. He wore a long hooded cloak, a wool garment, and sheepskin boots. There were a number of charms around his neck. He had a wooden bowl in his hand of the sort that mendicant dervishes carry to overcome their personal vanity and hubris by expecting the charity of others. I realized that here was a man who did not pay much attention to the judgments of society, that people could confuse him with some vagrant or even a beggar, did not seem to bother him in the least. As soon as I saw him standing there, awaiting permission to introduce himself, I sensed he was different. It was in his eyes, in his elaborate gesture, written all over him. Like an icon that might seem modest and vulnerable to ignorant eyes, but already heralded the proud oak tree that it will turn out to be. He looked at me with those piercing black eyes and nodded silently. "Welcome to our lodge, dervish," I said as I motioned for him to take a seat on the cushion across from me. After greeting everyone, the dervish sat down, inspecting the people in the room, taking in very detail. Finally, his gaze stopped at the judge. The two men looked at each other for a full minute without so much as a word, and I could not help wondering what each thought of the other, as they seemed so very opposite. I offered the dervish warm goat milk, sweetened figs, and filled dates, all of which he politely refused. When asked his name, he introduced himself as Sham of the Brace and said he was a wandering dervish searching for God high and low. "And where you able to find him?" I inquired. A shadow crossed his face as the dervish nodded and said, "Indeed, he was with me all along." The judge interjected with a smirk. He did not bother to hide. "I never understand why you dervishes make life so complicated. If God was with you all along, why did you rummage around this whole time in search of him?" Shams of the Brace bowed his head pensively and remained silent for a moment. When he looked up again, his face was calm, his voice measured. "Because although it is a fact that he cannot be found by seeking, only those who seek can find him." "Such wordplay," the judge scoffed. "Are you trying to tell us that we can't find God if we stay in the same place all our lives?" "That's nonsense. Not everyone needs to dress in tatters and hit the road like you." There followed a ripple of laughter as the men in the room were eager to show their agreement with the judge. High-pitched, unconfident, and unhappy laugh from people used to nodding to superiors. I felt uneasy. Obviously, it hadn't been a good idea to bring the judge and dervish together. Perhaps I was misunderstood. I did not mean to say one could not find God if he stayed in his hometown. "That is certainly possible," conceded the dervish. "There are people who have never traveled anywhere and yet have seen the world." "Exactly," the judge grinned triumphantly, a grin that vanishes upon hearing what the dervish uttered next. "What I meant to say, Judge, was that one could not find God if he stayed in the fur coats silk garment and pricey jewelry that you are wearing today. A stern silence descended upon the room, the sound and sail around us dissolving down to dust. We all held our breath, as if expecting something bigger to happen. Though, what could have been more shocking, I don't know. Your tongue is too sharp for a dervish, the judge said. When something needs to be said, I will say it, even if the whole world grab me by the neck and tell me to keep quiet. This was met with a frown from the judge, but then he shrugged dismissively. Well, whatever, he said. In any case, you are the man we need. We were talking about the splendor of our city. You must have seen many places. Is there a place more charming than Baghdad? Softly, his gaze moving from one man to another, Shams explained, there is no question, Baghdad is a remarkable city, but no beauty on earth lasts forever. Cities are erected on spiritual columns, like giant mirrors. They reflect the heart of their residents. If those hearts darken and lose faith, cities will lose their glamour. It happens, and it happens all the time. I could not help but nod. Shams of the Brace turned to me, momentarily distracted from his thought, with a friendly flicker in his eyes. I felt them on me, like the heat of a sweltering sun. That was when I clearly saw how he merited his name. This man was radiation, radiating vigor and vitality, and burning within, like a ball of fire. He was indeed Shams, the sun. But the judge was of a different mind. You Sufis make everything too complicated. The same with the philosophers and poets. Why the need for so many words? Human beings are simple creatures with simple needs. It falls upon the leader to see to their needs and make sure they do not go astray. That requires applying the Sharia to perfection. The Sharia is like a candle, said the Shams of the Brace. I provide us with much valuable light. But let us not forget that a candle helps us to go from one place to another in the dark. If we forget where we are headed and instead concentrate on the candle, what good it is. The judge grimaced, his face closing up. I felt a wave of anxiety wash over me. Entering into a discussion about the significance of the Sharia with a man whose job was to judge and often punish people according to the Sharia was swimming in dangerous water. Did not Shams know that? Just as I was looking for an appropriate excuse to take the dervish out of the room, I heard him saying, there is a rule that applies to this situation. What rule? The judge suspiciously. Shams of the Brace straightened up, his gaze fixed as if reading from an invisible book, and he pronounced, each and every reader comprehends the Holy Quran on a very different level, in tandem with the depth of his understanding. There are four levels of insight. The first level is the outer meaning, and it is the one that the majority of people are content with. Next is the batin, the inner level. Third, there is the inner of the inner. And the fourth level is so deep it cannot be put into words and is therefore bound to remain indiscreet. With glinting eyes, Shams continues. Scholars who focus on the Sharia know the outer meaning. Sufis know the inner meaning. Saints know the inner of the inner. And as for the fourth level, that is known only by Prophet and those closest to God. Are you telling me that an ordinary Sufi has a deeper grasp of the Quran than a Sharia scholar? The judge asked as he tapped his fingers on the bow. A subtle, sardonic smile curved the dervish's mouth, but he did not answer. Be careful, my friend, the judge said. There is a thin line between where you stand and sheer blasphemy. If there was a threat in these words, the dervish screamed not to have noticed it. What exactly is sheer blasphemy? He asked, and then with a sharp intake of breath, he added, allow me to tell you a story. And here is what he told us. One day, Musa was walking in the mountain of his own when he saw a shepherd in the distance. The man was on his knee with his hands spread out to the sky, praying. Musa was delighted.
But when he got closer, he was equally stunned to hear the shepherd's prayer. Oh my beloved God, I love thee more than thou can know. I will do anything for thee, just say the word. Even if thou ask me to slaughter the fattest sheep in my flock in thy name, I will do so without hesitation. Thou would roast it and put its tail fat in thy rice to make it more tasty. Musa inched toward the shepherd, listening intently. Afterward, I will wash thy feet and clean thine ears and pick thy lice for feed. That is how much I love thee. Having heard enough, Musa interrupted the shepherd, yelling, "Stop, you ignorant man. What do you think you are doing? Do you think God eats rice? Do you think God has feet for you to wash? This is not prayer. It is sheer blasphemy." Dazed and ashamed, the shepherd apologized repeatedly and promised to pray as decent people did. Musa taught him several prayers that afternoon. Then he went on his way, utterly pleased with himself. But that night Musa heard a voice. It was God. "Oh Musa, what have you done? You scolded that poor shepherd and failed to realize how dear he was to me. He might not be saying the right things in the right way, but he was sincere. His heart was pure and his intentions were good. I was pleased with him. His words might have been blasphemy to your ears, but to me they were sweet blasphemy." Musa immediately understood his mistake. The next day, early in the morning, he went back to the mountain to see the shepherd. He found him praying again, except this time he was praying in the way he had been instructed. In his determination to get the prayer right, he was stammering, bereft of the excitement and passion of his earlier prayer, regretting what he had done to him. Musa patted the shepherd's back and said, "My friend, I was wrong. Please forgive me. Keep praying in your own way. That is more precious in God's eyes." The shepherd was astonished to hear this, but even deeper was his relief. Nevertheless, he did not want to go back to his old prayer, neither did he abide by the former prayers that Musa had taught him. He had now found a new way of communicating with God, though satisfied and blessed in his naïf devotion. He was now past that stage, beyond his faith blessing. "So you see, don't judge the way other people connect to God," concluded Sam. "To each his own way and to his own prayer. God does not take us at our words. He looks deep into our hearts. It is not the ceremonies or rituals that make a difference, but whether our hearts are sufficiently pure or not. I checked the judge's face. I could see beneath his mask of absolute confidence and composure that he was clearly annoyed. Yet at the same time, being the astute man that he was, he had detected a tricky situation. If he reacted to Sham's story, he would have to take the next step and punish him for his insolence. In which case things would get serious and everybody would hear that a simple dervish had dared to confront the high judge. It was therefore better for him to pretend there was nothing to be upset about and leave it there. Outside, the sun was setting, painting the sky a dozen shades of crimson, punctuated now and again by dark gray clouds. In a little while, the judge rose to his feet, saying he had some important business to attend to. After giving me a slight nod and shams of the brace of posture, he strode off. His men followed wordlessly. "I am afraid the judge did not like you much," I said when everyone had left. Shams of the brace brushed his hair from his face, smiling. "Oh, that is quite all right. I am used to people not liking me much." I could not help feeling excited. I had been a master of this lodge long enough to know that it was not often such a visitor came. "Tell me, Darwish," I said, "what brings someone like you to Baghdad?" I was eager to hear his answer, but also strangely fearful of it. Ela, belly dancers and dervishes turned in Ela's dream on the night her husband did not come home. Her head resting on the manuscript, she watched a rough-looking warrior dined at a roadside inn. Their plates piled high with delicious pies and desserts. Then she saw herself. She was searching for someone in bustling bazaar in a foreign country. All around her, people moved slowly, as if dancing to a tune she could not hear. She stopped a fat man with a dropping mustache to ask something. Only she could not remember the question. The man looked at her blankly and hobbled away. She tried to talk to several vendors and then shoppers, but no one responded to her. At first, she thought it was because she could not speak their language. Then she put her hand to her mouth and realized with horror that her tongue had been cut off. With increasing panic, she looked around for a mirror to see her reflection and figure out if she was still the same person, but there was none in the bazaar. She started to cry and woke up to a disturbing sound, not knowing whether she still had a tongue. When Ella opened her eyes, she found Spirit frantically scratching at the back door. An animal had probably gotten onto the porch, driving the dog crazy. Skunks made him particularly nervous. The memory of his inappropriate encounter with one last winter was still fresh. It had taken Ella's weeks to remove that nasty odor from the dog. And even after she would wash him in tubs of tomato juice, the smell lingered, reminiscent of burning rubber. Ella glanced at the clock of the wall. It was 3:15 in the morning. David was still not back, and perhaps he never would be. Janet had not returned her call, and in her pessimistic state, Ella doubted she ever would. Seized by the terror of being abandoned by her husband and daughter, she opened the fridge and looked through it for a few minutes. The desire to scoop out some cherry vanilla ice cream wired with the fear of gaining weight. With no small effort, she took a step away from the fridge and slammed the door, a bit more harshly than necessary. Then Ella opened a bottle of red wine and poured herself a glass. It was good wine, light and lively, with an underlying hint of bitter sweetness that she liked. Only when she was filled the second glass did it occur to her she might have opened one of David's expensive bottles. She checked the label's tissue, Norgex 1996. Not knowing what to make of that, she frowned at the bottle. She was too tired and too sleepy to read anymore, so she decided to check her email. There, among half a dozen junk emails and a message from Michael inquiring about how the manuscript was going, she found an email from Aziz Z. Zahra. "Dear Ella, if I may, your email found me in a village in Guatemala called Momestenango. It's one of the few places left where they still use Mayan calendar. Right across from my hostel, there is a wish tree bedecked with hundreds of pieces of fabric of every color and pattern you can imagine. They call it the tree of broken hearted. Those with broken hearts write their name on a piece of paper and tie these to the branches, praying for their hearts to be healed. I hope you won't find this too brusque message. But after reading your email, I went to the Vishpuri and prayed that you and your daughter solve this misunderstanding. Even a speck of love should not go unappreciated, because as Rumi said, love is the water of life. One thing that has helped me personally in the past was to stop interfering with the people around me and getting frustrated when I could not change them. Instead of instruction and passivity, may I suggest submission? Some people make the mistake of confusion, submission with weakness, whereas it is anything but. Submission is a form of peaceful acceptance of the terms of the universe, including the things we are currently unable to change or comprehend. According to the Mayan calendar, today is an auspicious day. A major astrological shift is on its way, ushering in a new human consciousness. I need to hurry to send you this email before the sun sets and the day is over. May love find you where you least expect.
Yours sincerely, Aziz. Initiates of the laptop moved to learn that a complete stranger in a remote corner of a world had prayed for her well-being. She closed her eyes and imagined her name written on a piece of paper tied to a wish tree, dangling like a kite in the air, free and happy. A few minutes later, she opened the kitchen door and stepped out into the backyard, enjoying the unsettling coolness of the breeze. Spirit stood beside her, uneasy and growling, constantly sniffing the air. The dog's eyes grew small, then big and anxious, and his ears kept perking up, as if he had recognized in the distance something scary. Ella and her dog stood side by side under the late spring moon, staring into the thick, vast darkness, similarly frightened of the things moving in the dark, frightened of the unknown.
The novice, booing and scrapping. I showed the gist to the door and quickly returned to the main room to collect the dirty bowls. I was surprised to find Baba Zaman and Wandering Dervish in the same position and when I left them. Neither one saying a word. Out of the corner of my eye, I checked them, wondering if it could be possible to carry on a conversation without talking. I lingered there as long as I could, arranging the cushions, tidying up the room, picking up the crumbs on the carpet. But after a while, I ran out of reasons to stay. Half-heartedly, I dragged my feet back to the kitchen. As soon as he saw me, the cook started to rain orders. Wipe the counter, mop the floor, wash the dishes, scrub the stove and the walls around the grill. And when you are done, don't forget to check the mousetraps. Ever since I would came to this lot some 6 months ago, the cook had been riding rough shots over me. Every day he made me work like a dog and called this torture a part of my spiritual training, as if washing greasy dishes could be spiritual in any way. A man of few words, the cook had one favorite mantra. Cleaning is praying, praying is cleaning. If that were true, all the housewives in Baghdad would have become spiritual masters, I once dared to say. He threw a wooden spoon at my head and yelled at the top of his lungs. Such back talk will get you now here, son. If you want to become a dervish, be as mute as that wooden spoon. Rebelliousness is not a good quality in any ways. Speak less, mature quicker. I hated the cook, but more than that, I feared him. I had never disobeyed his order, that is, until this evening. As soon as the cook turned his back, I sneaked out of the kitchen and tiptoed to the main room again, dying to learn more about the wandering dervish. Who was he? What was he doing here? He was not like the dervish in the lodge. His eyes looked fierce and unruly. Even when he bowed his head in the modesty, there was something so unusual and unpredictable about him that it was almost frightening. I peeped through a crack in the door. At first, I could not see anything, but soon my eyes adjusted to the semi-dark inside the room, and I could make out their face. I heard the master ask, "Tell me, Shams of the Breeze, what brings someone like you to Baghdad? Have you seen this place in a dream?" The dervish shook his head. "No, it was not a dream that brought me here. It was a vision. I never have dreams." "Everybody has dreams," Baba Zaman said tenderly. "It's just that you might not remember them all the time. But that doesn't mean you don't dream." "But I do not," the dervish insisted. "It is a part of a deal I made with God. You see, when I was a boy, I saw angels and watched the mysteries of the universe unfold before my eyes. When I told this to my parents, they were not pleased and told me to stop dreaming. When I confided in my friends, they too said I was a hopeless dreamer. I tried talking to my teachers, but their response was no different. Finally, I understood that whenever people hear something unusual, they call it a dream. I begin to dislike the words and all it is represented." Upon seeing this, the dervish paused as if he had heard a sudden sound. The strangest thing happened. He stood up, straightened his spine, and slowly, deliberately began to walk toward the door, all the while looking in my direction. It was as if he somehow knew I was peeing on them. My heart pounded like mad. I wanted to run back to the kitchen, but could not see how. My arms, my legs, my whole body flew through and beyond the door. The dark eyes of him of the place were fixed upon me, as terrified as I was. I also felt a tremendous amount of energy rushing through my body. He approached, put his hand on the door handle, but just when I thought he was about to open the door and catch me, he stopped. I could not see his face from this close, and had no idea what had changed his mind. He waited like that for an unbearably long time. Then he turned his back, and as he paced away from the door, he continued with his story. When I got a little older, I asked God to take away my ability to dream, so that every time I encountered him, I would know I wasn't dreaming. He agreed. He took them all away. That's why I never dream. Shams of the Breeze now stood by the open windows across the room. Outside, there was a little drizzle, and he watched it pensively before he said, God took away my ability to dream, but to compensate for that loss, he allowed me to interpret the dream of others. I am a dream interpreter. I expected Baba Zaman not to believe this nonsense and to scold him, as he scolds me all the time. But instead, the master nodded respectfully and said, You seem to be an unusual person. Tell me, what can I do for you? I don't know. Actually, I was hoping you could tell me that. What do you mean? Asked the master, sounding puzzled. For almost 40 years, I have been a wandering dervish. I am skilled in the ways of nature, although the ways of society are still aligned to me. If necessary, I can fight like a wild animal, but I myself cannot hurt anyone. I can name the constellation in the sky, identify the trees in the forest, and read like an open book the type of people that Almighty has created in His image. Shams paused briefly and waited as the master lit an oil lamp. Then he continued, One of the rules says, You can study God through everything and everyone in the universe, because God is not confined in the mosque, synagogue, or church. But if you are still in need of knowing where exactly His abode is, there is only one place to look for Him, in the heart of a true lover. There is no one who has lived after seeing Him, just like there is no one who has died after seeing Him. Whoever finds Him will remain with Him forever. In that dim, flickering light, Shams of the Breeze seemed even taller, his hair falling to his shoulder in disorderly waves. But knowledge is like brackish water at the bottom of an old vase unless it flows somewhere. For years, I prayed to God for a companion to share the knowledge accumulated inside me. Finally, in a vision in Samarkand, I have been told I should come to Baghdad to fulfill my destiny. I understand that you know the name of my companion and his whereabouts and will tell me, if not now, then later. Outside, the night had settled, and a wedge of moonlight streamed into the open windows. I realized how late it was. The cook must have been looking for me, but I don't care. For once, it felt good to break the rules. I don't know what kind of answer you are asking of me, murmured the master. But if there is a piece of information I am destined to reveal, I know it will happen in due time. Until then, you can stay here with us. Be our guest. Upon hearing this, the wandering dervish bowed humbly and gratefully to kiss Baba Zaman's hand. That is when the master asked the bizarre question. You say you are ready to deliver all your knowledge to other person. You want to hold the truth in your palm as if it were a precious pearl and offer it to someone special. But opening up someone's heart to spiritual light is no small task for a human being. Just stealing God's thunder, what are you willing to pay in return? For as long as I live, I will never forget the answer the Darvish gave them. Raising an eyebrow, he said, firmly, I am willing to give my head. I flinched, feeling a cold shiver travel down my spine. When I put my eye to the crack again, I noticed that the master looked shaken by the answer as well. Perhaps we have done enough talking for today, Baba Zaman exhaled and said. You must be tired. Let me call the youngest. He will show you to your bed and provide 2 sheets and a glass of milk. Now Shams of the Breeze turned toward the dog, and I felt down to my bones that he was gazing at me again. More than that, it was as if he were looking through and into me, studying the bits and pieces of my soul, inspecting secrets that were hidden even from me. Perhaps he was involved with black magic or had been trained by Harut and Marut, the two angels of Babylon that the Quran warned us against. Or else he possessed supernatural talent that helped him to see through the doors and walls. Either way, he scared me. No need to call the noise, he said, his voice attaining a high pitch. I have a feeling he is nearby and has already heard us. I let out a gasp so loud it might have woken the dead in their graves. In utter panic, I jumped to my feet and scurried into the garden, seeking refuge in the dark. But an unpleasant surprise was awaiting me there. So there you are, you little rascal, yelled the cook as he ran toward me with broom in his hand. You are in big trouble, son, big trouble. I jumped aside and managed to duck the broom at the last minute. Come here or I will break your legs, the cook shouted behind me, puffing. But I did not. Instead, I dashed out of the garden as fast as an arrow. While the face of Shams of Tabriz shimmered before my eyes, I ran and ran along the winding trail that connected the lodge to the main road. And even after I had gotten far away, I could not stop running. My heart pounding, my throat dried up. I ran until my knees gave out,